Good evening, students. Today we will discuss the next topic of our discussion in DA, that is on dynamic programming, where we will be studying two of the algorithms, that is the Warshall's algorithms and the Floyd's algorithm. Both are related to the graph problems. So let's understand basically what is a dynamic programming. A dynamic programming is generally an algorithm. It's a design technique. As all of you remember in the first part of our discussion in the introductory classes, the process of algorithmic analysis, we are in the third step of finding or finalizing the design technique. So this is also one of the design technique for solving the problems which can be defined with the overlapping recurrences. So in divide and conquer also we have some recurrences being written, but these are the overlapping recurrences written with the overlapping subproblems. So this technique was invented by the American mathematician Richard Bellman in 50s to solve the optimization problem. Till date also dynamic programming technique is best suitable for the optimization problems. So the main idea here is to set up a recurrence relation which is a solution for a larger instance, and to set it up with the smaller instances of the larger problem, solve the smaller instances, record the solutions in a table, and then record the solutions in a table, extract the solution to the initial instances of that table. You'll understand the beauty of dynamic programming after we discuss some of the examples. The best example of the dynamic programming is the Fibonacci numbers, where the Fibonacci numbers are expressed. You can see f of n to be equal to f of n minus 1 and f of n minus 2. So the solution for this can be written in the form of a tree represented as f of n and smaller instances and so on, and finally combine the solutions to get the final solution. So of course we are not going into the Fibonacci numbers, solving the Fibonacci numbers recursively, but we are going for the two examples, Warshall's and Floyd's algorithm, for finding the for solving some graph related problems. So the other examples which can be solved using the dynamic programming, I will be calling it as a DP from now, so would be the binomial coefficient and change making problems. And as a binomial coefficient, as all of you know, it's a coefficient in a binomial term where we try to find out the coefficient in the simplest way by the dynamic programming. However, if you apply the regular mathematical way, it is little difficult. And similarly, the binary search tree, so building an optimal binary search tree, that's another important problem which can be solved. And in case of the Warshall's algorithm, we are trying to find out the transitive closure of a given graph which will help us to find out a path from one source vertex to all other vertices if present. Similarly, in the Floyd's algorithm, we are going to find out the shortest path. In Warshall's, a path. In Floyd's, shortest path. So Warshall's works just with the existence of a path, but Floyd algorithm works with the existence of the weights and the path. And some other optimization problems which we will be studying is a knapsack, and even the traveling salesman problem which we discussed in the initial classes of the DA can be solved using a dynamic programming. So the one which are shown with the red colored are what we are going to study in this presentation. We will be studying the Warshall's and Floyd's. Let's start our discussion with the Warshall's algorithm. Warshall's algorithm, the basic idea of this algorithm is, given a directed graph, we are interested to find out if there is a path from one vertex to other and from the other vertex to another, then from the source vertex to another vertex, is there a path? If yes, then we'll try to develop this. So it is like how, you know, we have a path from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, then we have a path from 1 to 3. So can we reach from 1 to 3 or not? Or from one to other vertices or not? That is what we are going to study with respect to the Warshall's algorithm. So what it does, it finds out the transitive closure. What is the meaning of transitive closure? Simple terms, I have a path from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, then I have path to reach from 1 to 3. This is a basic example. For example, if you see this graph, we have 4 edges. From 1, I can reach 3. This is an initial adjacency matrix representation. And from 2, I can reach only 1. I can even reach 4. Similarly, it means that if I want to reach from 2 to 3, I can reach how? You can see here, this is a final adjacency matrix. From 2, I can reach 1. From 2, I can reach 4. And from 2, I can even reach 3. Right? And even from 2, I can even reach back to 2 because we have a path from 2 to 4 and 4 to 2. So you can see here, this is what we're trying to develop with respect to a given directed graph and its transitive closure. If you see this resultant graph, we have a loop being shown. What is a loop? A self loop, you can say. I can reach back the same vertex through some other path, right? So this is what we are trying to show. You can see the darkened lines show the edges which are darkened, show the edges between the vertices and these value of 1 that you can see. So this is the basic logic as we do it in regular classes. The basic logic is I have a path from one vertex to another. We'll understand the logic of the Warshall's algorithm. I have a path from one vertex to another. So then can I reach the another vertex from some other vertex? So this is the basic logic. So you can, this is a formal definition given, constructing a transitive closure. Closure here means it's an adjacency matrix which are represented by the values 0 and 1, where 1 represents the existence of an edge, 0 represents no edge. So when we begin, this is typically represented as r raised to 0 in brackets, where r raised to 0 ij means the a particular element in the ith row and jth column, if it is 1, if there is a non-trivial path from I to j with only first k vertices allowed as intermediate vertices. First k means the vertices that come in between I and j. So those are assumed to be the k vertices. So the value of r of ij for the k vertices will be 1 if there is a path existing. It's not like a direct edge existing. Please understand this clearly. It's a non-trivial path existing. And similarly, this value will be 0 if there is no path existing. So you can just note that the adjacency matrix representation of a given graph is represented as r raised to 0. And similarly, the final transitive closure will be represented as r raised to n. So you can see, you all can make an observation from this. This is a stepwise representation or the solution for the Warshall's algorithm to find out the transitive closure. This is the adjacency matrix and this is a transitive closure matrix. Why it is only r raised to 4? Because there are 4 vertices. Okay, so this is a basic logic of Warshall's algorithm. In every iteration, we are going to consider one of the row and one of the column, and then we are going to update if there are any non-trivial paths existing. With what logic? With this logic. What is that logic? The value of rkij, value of rij for the k intermediate vertices will be equal to the value of rij k minus 1 when there is a path existing already, or else we are going to consider the logic of, is there a path from I to K, R I K. You can see in this graph, I to K and from K to J. If there is a path from I to K and K to J, then there is a path from I to J. This is a simple basic logic. Understand this. Just you need to remember this logic. Nothing difficult about this algorithm, and this is a basic rule of how we go for updating the matrix, how we are going to generate the matrix. So this recurrence you are supposed to remember as far as this particular topic of Warshall's algorithm is considered. Do not try to burden with other things. We are going to update a row and a column if there is a trivial path existing. And what is the logic? If there is a path, we are going to keep it 1. If there is no path, then we are going to consider I to K, K to J. So K is the intermediate vertex. So the rule that you can follow, if an element in a row of I and a column J is 1, then RK remains 1. Okay, so this is the same thing what I told you, same thing is expressed in the form of two rules. So if an element in row I and column J is 0, in RK minus 1, it has to be changed to 1. If and only if there is a path from RIK, I to K and K to J. This is a basic logic. So this is a stepwise solution for the example. You can see this is the four vertex graph. This is the adjacency matrix representation in the form of R is to 0. And now you can see the red line represents, we are going to consider the first row and first column, and we are going to compare, except the diagonal elements, we are going to compare each and every vertex for a transitive closure or the path that can be existing. For example, you can see, if you consider this second row element, which is 1, and the first column element, okay, a second element, if you take this one as first row and first column, so first element in first row and first column is 0, so need not change. Now if you go for the element in the first row, second element in the first row, and the second element in the first row, and the second element in the first column, if you compare, this is 1 and 0. It means you cannot update this. There is no trivial path. But however, if you go for the second element in the third element in the first row and second element in the first column, right? So you can see that there is a path existing, because this is 1, this is 1. Please listen this carefully. This is the basic logic. So with this, I can update in R raised to 1 this value, which is 1. You can see it is a bolded, it is a darkened 1. You can see this. Similarly, if you consider this 0, so it is already, there is 1. I need not do any changes. Similarly, in R raised to 1, first, second row, second column, and each one of the diagonal elements, like in this case, if you consider the first element of the second row is compared with the first element of the first second column, so it is 0, so you need not update. You can see in R is to 2 it is 0. Similarly, so this remains 0 as 0. Similarly, if you compare this 1 with this element, this remain, it is 1 already here, so I did not update. Similarly, this is 1 and 0, this is as it is. So what I suggest to all of you is, when you try to build this, if there is a 0, you need not have to make any changes. Whatever is there in the adjacency matrix, keep it as it is. Now there is interesting point. If you consider this third element of the column and the third element of this second row, so you can see it is 0, so you need not have to update anything. But whereas if you consider the fourth element of the second column and third element, so this is 1 and 1, so I have to update this to 1 as well as this one. So you can see these three are the darkened lines. Now talking about the last element in the first column of R raised to 2, this is 1. Why? Because the first element in the second row, last element in the second column, together there is a trivial path, so this is 1. Right, so just you have to make some observation for 2 minutes, you'll come to know what is happening here. And similarly, this logic continues for the third column, third row, fourth column, fourth row, to get the final resultant matrix, which is R raised to 4, because there are 4 vertices and this is the final transitive closure matrix for the given algorithm. So according to this, from 1 I can reach 3, you can see in the graph. And from 2, I can reach all the vertices, because 2 to 1, 2 to 4, 2 to 3, and 2 to 2 itself. So you can see all ones. And from 4, I can reach 2, 1, 3. So you can see this. So this will help us in a regular practical applications where we wanted to find out, is there a path between one place to another place to reach, given a one way in a given city or a place or a geographical area. So we can use the Warshall's algorithm in that case. Here the weights are not important, only the is there a path existing or not is important. So this is the algorithm. This is I can say it is a non-recursive algorithm, straightforward, where there will be three for loops. One, the inner for loop is for the column. The second inner for loop is for the row, and the outer for loop, this is k equal to 1 to n, is for the intermediate vertices. So this formula, you are just supposed to remember this formula as far as this algorithm is considered. Remaining thing, with your understanding, you can very easily build it. And as you know, with respect to this, if you try to solve this particular equation for the time efficiency, this will come sigma of j equal to n, sigma of I equal to 1 to n, sigma of k equal to 1 to n, and the basic operation executed will be 1. So with that, you will get it under the theta of n cube. Okay, so this is the time efficiency of the Warshall's algorithm, right? So you can have a look at this, and once again you can find out how the things are going. The input is the adjacency matrix and output is the transitive closure of the tie graph. Remember, the Warshall's algorithm works on the directed graph. From now, in the dynamic programming, most of the examples are on the directed graph. Now looking at this, you will be interested to see, we have a path. Can we have a shortest path? So when you think like this, then we will be landing in another algorithm called as the Floyd's algorithm. So what is a Floyd's algorithm? It is an algorithm to find out the shortest paths in a directed graph. So this word you have heard in the Dijkstra's algorithm and some other algorithms, Kruskal's algorithm, but it works on the direct undirected graph, but this is on a directed graph, a graph with the directions and the weights. So the difference between the Warshall's and Floyd's is, Warshall's works with the path without the weights, but Floyd's algorithm works with the weights. So what is the basic problem here is, to once again, just like in the Warshall's, we are developing a transitive closure, but here we are trying to develop a weighted matrix. We are going to develop, which is nothing but the last matrix after applying the Floyd's algorithm, and this matrix will have the shortest path. First it will have whether there will be a path or not, and if there is a path, how the shortest path is formed. So the logic of Floyd's remains almost similar to the Warshall's algorithm. The the only difference is, instead of just having rk minus 1 ij, we are just going to put a simple word called as minimal. What is this minimal? So concentrate on this graph. I have path from I to k, k to j. Okay, so if there is a path from I to k and k to j, there is a path from I to j. This is a Warshall's algorithm. Now what I will be doing is, if there is a path from I to k and k to j, right, and if there is a direct path from some other methods to I to j, then out of these two paths, which is the smallest, I am going to consider. So minimal. Observe this. Dk minus 1 ij, dk minus 1 I to k, k to j. There it was a r. Now here it is just a d. What is a d? Distance. Getting it? So please observe this. Dk ij minimal, dk minus 1 ij. So in both Warshall's and Floyd's, I will not burden you to remember many things. It is a simple. This you have to remember, this equation. In case of the Warshall's, it is r, and it is replaced by d. D represents the distance, and we are going to add a simple word, minimal, because our intention is to find out the shortest paths between every pair of vertices. But in Warshall's, a path, the shortest path is removed, a non-trivial path between every pair of vertices. So look at this, these two words will make you to remember another algorithm and solve it. And the way it is solved is similar to the Warshall's. This is the graph, directed graph. I can say more specifically, it is a weighted connected direct graph. So for this graph, we have the given adjacency matrix. So here it is represented as infinite. So how to represent infinite in the programming? Simple, it is use some large values like 999, 49, 59 and so on to represent the infinite. So this is the initial adjacency matrix represented as d raised to 0. Why it is called as d raised to 0 is, it is the distance weighted matrix, or a distance matrix, you can say. Okay, so again, the rule remains the same. consider the first row, first column, and try to see whether there is a shortest path between one vertex to another vertex. For example, if you consider this e raised to 0 from the second vertex to the third vertex, right, I can reach it, right, with a path value, with a path and a value of 5, 2 plus 3, 5. So you can see this 5 is being shown here. But what is the previous value here? Infinite. From 2, you can see from 2 to reach 3, there is no path. 3 to 2, there is a path. But 2 to 3, there is no path. So it is infinite. Okay. Similarly, if you consider this 6, that is the fourth vertex and the third vertex. 3 doesn't represent third vertex. It is a weight. Okay. So third vertex, fourth vertex to third vertex, there is no path. However, to reach the third vertex via 1, there is a path. So this has the value of 6, which is represented by this element, plus 3. 6 plus 3, that is 9. So you can see this is being highlighted. Similarly, we have to consider this. There is second row and second column. And with this, if I take the first element, that is the 2. So if you consider this, if you consider this 7, that is the second column's third element and the first element of the second row. So what does this represent? That is the third vertex to the second vertex, you can see. So to reach the path, it will be 2 plus 7, that is 9. So this will be updated over here. So there will not be any other updations in the d raised to 1 to d raised to 2. And similarly, d raised to 2 to d raised to 3, there is one more updation happening, you can see. Okay, so what is that updation? Lots of updations are happening. This is 10. What is the 10? To reach the second vertex so we have value of 10. To reach the third vertex, third vertex from the second vertex, that is from 2 to 3, you can see this is 2, this is 3. Okay, so the third vertex, that is the third vertex 3 and the second vertex. So don't worry about what values you'll be getting over here. So just go on updating whatever the values that you are going to get it. Okay, so we'll get a value of 7 plus 3. Where is 7 here? This is the 7. So to reach third vertex, right? Third vertex via some other path, you are going to get a value of 10. That is to reach 1. So what is this value of 10? This is the first vertex. To reach the second vertex from first vertex, that is this 3 plus 7, that is 10. Okay, so don't worry whether this column element represents a vertex or what. You just apply the logic. Which logic? This logic you have to go on applying. So by this, you can update the values. For example, so this one, this third row, third column and third row, this is 1. 1 is compared with 3. So this is infinite. Update this as 4. This you update it as 6. Getting it? Similarly, this is infinite. So 9 plus 7 is 16. So you can update. But you'll have a doubt. Those you have not understood, 9 plus 6 is 16. So this is not updated. So just don't think of which vertex you are doing. Apply the logic to this matrix. And finally, when you get it, you can cross-check very easily. Okay. So now one more thing that I would like to discuss is this 7. 7 is updated because there is a 9 over here. But when you compare like this, 1 plus 6, that comes to 9, 7. So you have 7 being updated for this element. That is the third element of the first column. That is 0, 3 element. Okay, so this is updated. So like this, just like the Warshall's algorithm, you start with e raised to 0, we'll get with e raised to 4 for 4 vertices. And this is the weighted matrix which has the shortest paths to reach from one vertex to all other vertices. So you can see, for example, if you consider this 3, so from 1 to reach 3, there is a path 3. From 1 to reach 4, there is a path 3 plus 1, so like this. So in case of Dijkstra's and other algorithms, we'll find out the via nodes also, but that is, we are not going to list it out. However, you can continue this Floyd's algorithm with respect to listing the intermediate vertices as well. Okay, so this is the algorithm, no change, just the simple word called as minimum. So don't try to burden yourself by remembering the algorithms, right? Instead of R, you have to use T. Instead of without a flower bracket, you have to put a flower bracket and write a min. What is this min representing? The minimum of the existing distance and the intermediate distance we are going to consider. So the input is the weight, the adjacency matrix or weight matrix, and the output is the distance matrix. Okay, so what is the difference in the weight matrix and distance matrix? Weight matrix is like adjacency matrix filled up with the weights given to the edges. Distance matrix is also like a weight matrix, but the distances over here represent the shortest distances between any two vertices. Any element in the distance matrix represents the shortest distance. That is the difference. Okay, so this is the time efficiency will be straightforward. Sigma of j equal to 1 to n. Then outer sigma of I equal to 1 to n, right? And sigma of k equal to n to n, 1 to n, that represents around n cube. So that is the time efficiency, a straightforward algorithm, right? So this is about the Floyd's algorithm and the Warshall's. This is an example, a textbook example, you can see. So you can solve this. I have given the solution as well. So there are four vertices. From 1 to reach 2, there is a path, and from 1 to reach 3, there is a path, and from 1 to reach 4, there is a path. So this is a simple input graph given. The solution for this, you have to find out by yourselves, because this is a textbook exercise problem. So try to solve this. I have given the solution as well, but before you go for the solution, you just find out the way it can be done. So this is how it is, it can be done. So this is the final adjacency matrix or the transitive closure matrix. You can see a kind of a graphical shape, triangular shape being shown. What does this represent? From 1, I can reach 2, 3, 4. And from 2, I can reach 3, 4. And from 3, I can reach only 4. It means from 4, I cannot reach anyone. Yes, that is the output. Similarly, for Floyd's algorithm also, I have given a 5, the author has given a 5 vertex input graph as an example, and this infinite represents the values that there are no paths. So I'll just explain one of the rows, right? For this, this is d raised to 0, this is d raised to 1. So you can see for d raised to 0, we have to consider the 0th row and the 0th column, or the first row and the first column. So here the values will be updated only for those row and column intersection elements where we have some distance being written. For example, if you consider this 6 and 8, so this is, there is an intersection over here, and this intersection represents a 14 value, but there is an infinite, just updated. Similarly, 3 and 2, this should be incremented to 5, and similarly 3 to 1, this is 4. We have to update this to 4, and remaining all infinite, and t you need not have to worry. 3 plus infinite is how much? Infinite. So that is not updated. Okay, so there has to be some fixed value. So this is a final distance matrix that you will get it. So try to solve this in home, and thank you very much for listening to this lecture on Warshall's and Floyd's algorithm. These are the references. My special thanks to NN Levitin for sharing his knowledge and materials through the textbook and other sources, and even the other textbook which is prescribed for our discussion. So this is what I wanted to discuss. So if you have any doubts, you can just get in touch with me. So don't be panic about any situations. Just concentrate on your work, studies, and whatever the instructions are given by the government, just follow them. Stay home, stay safe. Thank you. All the best. We shall meet in some next lecture. Thank you.